Wednesday morning. Good morning. This is ITV1 with GMTV. A visa in just 19 days, the dramatic allegations threatening to engulf David Blunkett in more controversy. Good morning, this is the News Hour on GMTV.
It's 6 o'clock on Wednesday, the 1st of December.
On the programme this morning, he continues to deny any wrongdoing, but today the Home Secretary faces more scrutiny amid reports that his former lover's nanny did seem to have her application for residency fast-tracked.
After the brutal murder of a father on his own doorstep, how safe are we in our own homes? It's now estimated a burglary occurs every 37 seconds in Britain, and we'll be asking what can be done about that.
On World AIDS Day, Claire Sweeney joins us to talk about an emotional trip to South Africa where one in five adults now has HIV.
And we're live down under once more where Paul Burrell's family join us for an exclusive interview. And didn't he do well on his challenge a while ago? The family of Paul Burrell in 20 minutes' time.
Before all that, some Christmas cheer on the 1st of December. Here's Claire.
Actually, I don't think we have Claire.
Oh, sorry, sadly we don't have Claire, but we are hoping to have Claire, who's in Lanarkshire. But first we're going to our top story. Letters published in the Daily Mail are threatening to embroil Home Secretary David Blunkett in greater controversy. They appear to show that a visa application for his lover's nanny was fast-tracked in just 19 days. Well, Sue Jameson's in Westminster for us. Sue, this is the row that just won't go away.
Well, it's certainly piling the pressure, I think, on Mr. Blunkett and on those around him, because these are the letters printed here. Now, they appear to show that on the 23rd of April 2003, this nanny, Luce Kasami, was told it could take up to a year for her visa application to be processed because there was quite a backlog. And then there's another letter dated clearly the 12th of May 2003, in which she's told that she has this indefinite leave to remain in the country, which you can get after 4 years, and it was granted quite a few weeks before she had been here exactly 4 years. Now, these letters in themselves do not implicate Mr. Blunkett. However, they are, of course, circumstantial evidence and an absolutely crucial part of the paper trail that Sir Alan Budd, the man now has been appointed to look into this whole review, he's going to have to follow the paper trail, find out what happened between that first letter being sent and the second one. And really the questions are still about how much involvement Mr. Blunkett had. Did he hand the letter on to somebody and say, could you have a look at this? He's already said that he wanted to check that it was actually a valid application. Was it fast-tracked simply because of that? The Tories, meanwhile, are still piling on pressure, saying there are other allegations about privileges that he's supposed to have given to Mrs. Quinn, parliamentary privileges. The Tories say they want a full investigation into that too. So you're right, this row is not going away anytime soon.
Sue, thanks very much.
The rest of the news this morning from Jackie at the news desk.
Thank you, Andrew. Good morning. Good morning. Police are waiting to interview the injured wife of murdered London banker John Monckton. The couple was stabbed during what appears to have been an attempted burglary at their home in the city's Chelsea district. Detectives are hunting for two youths who were seen in the area prior to the attack on Monday night. Detectives in Scotland believe a bank manager shot dead at his home in Nairn at the weekend may have been the victim of a grudge. Police are searching for an envelope given to 30-year-old Alistair Wilson by his killer moments before he was shot three times. The attacker fled with the envelope. Mr. Wilson's widow, Veronica, is to make an appeal for information later this morning. MPs are planning the biggest crackdown on animal cruelty for almost a century with the introduction of an animal welfare bill. It'll require pet owners to ensure best possible care for their animals and give the RSPCA the power to act if they think an animal's at risk. Aruj Dufwicha reports.
These are the kind of squalid conditions thousands of animals are forced to live in every day. Yet it's totally legal. The RSPCA says the proposed bill will save animals like these. Today it's launching its own campaign in support of the government's plans. Gail Porter, Uri Geller and Miranda Richardson are among a host of celebrities supporting the campaign.
The camera can't really, you know, smell what is going on here, but it's just appalling. It's disgusting.
Gail Porter visited a home where eight cats are kept in baskets.
It's like sitting in this all week.
This dingy living room has been turned into a filthy aviary. The birds can fly, but they don't get any natural light. The RSPCA says it's time to stop this kind of abuse.
Last year, our inspectors gave out 4,000 written warnings advising people on how to improve the care they were giving to their animals. Sadly, in too many of those cases, the advice was ignored.
The bill puts the onus on pet owners to keep their animals in good, clean conditions. If they don't, they may face prosecution.
MPs will today hear evidence from the families of four army recruits who died while stationed at the Deep Cut Barracks in Surrey. The Commons Select Defence Committee is leading the inquiry into the army's treatment of young soldiers. The government announced an independent review of abuse allegations yesterday, but stopped short of the public inquiry the families want. The father and sister of a British woman murdered in Japan are flying to Tokyo to hear evidence against the man accused of killing her. Lucy Blackman disappeared in July 2000 while working as a hostess in a Tokyo nightclub. Her remains were discovered in a cave outside Tokyo 7 months later. A Japanese property developer is on trial for her murder. World AIDS Day gets underway this morning with a campaign to highlight the plight of the 58 million people who live with the disease worldwide. TV star Claire Sweeney, a Save the Children ambassador, has just returned from South Africa, where she's been visiting children with HIV and AIDS. The former Brookside actress spent a week in the country, where 250,000 children and 5 million adults have the disease. The festive season got underway in America last night with the traditional lighting of the giant Christmas tree at the Rockefeller Center in New York. No one could accuse the Americans of doing things by halves, and this year's tree is the biggest and brightest in its 70-year history. 71 feet high and studded with 30,000 lights. Very nice too. Now for a look at the weather. Anne Clare, you're in Lanarkshire this morning spreading some Christmas cheer.
Hello, good morning, Jackie. Yes, and behind me, apparently, is the largest Christmas tree, not only in Britain, but also in Europe. It's 41 metres high, and I'm just trying to convert that into feet. I don't really know how many feet that is. And there's a star on the top, and a very brave person put that there, because I wouldn't have done it so tall. And in fact, this morning, it's very Christmassy in South Lanarkshire, despite the fact it's rather chilly, and we're seeing a lot of clouds covering any part of southern Scotland, northern England, as well as down to Wales and eastern Ireland. Now, to the northwest of that, it's cold, it's frosty, it's clear with some fog patches. And to the south, you're seeing some cloud this morning, but down in the southeast, that's where you could see some brighter spells, despite the fact there will be some patchy fog. Patchy fog in the far northwest as well. And through the day, very little change, but at least on both sides of the country, you'll see a little bit of sunshine. In the middle, rather damp. Now it's back to Penny and Andrew.
Well, it's me, actually, but I'll hand back to them in a minute. 6 minutes past seven now. It's back to Andrew and Penny.
Thank you very much.
The front pages this morning, and in the Daily Telegraph, a picture of John Monckton, who we'll be talking about later on, lost his life 2 days ago, and his wife, who was stabbed on the doorstep of their Chelsea home. A dying woman free to commit suicide, landmark judgment from the courts yesterday. She's a woman suffering from an incurable brain disease. She was told yesterday that the High Court would not stop her from travelling to Switzerland for an assisted suicide because she has mental capacity. So that's in the Telegraph this morning. Scorn Brown to make his push for number 10, says The Times this morning. And in The Guardian, Brown hit by economy warning. A think tank is predicting rate rises and questions spending ahead of a possible May election next year.
That terrible murder of John Monckton on the front pages of The Mirror and The Sun. Torn apart is the headline in The Daily Mirror. Millionaire stabbed to death by burglars at 7:30 in the evening in front of his wife and daughter, who's 9 years old. And that's the same on the front page of The Sun, their headline destroyed. The Daily Mail, our lead story, which we'll be following up again a bit later on, revealed Nanny got her visa in 19 days. And the Daily Express, the estate agent's newspaper, probably. House prices are still rising. There is no slump, according to a new survey, which is unusual because the Daily Express, which has been plotting this for some time, for some 2 years, in fact, only recently said that house prices were slumping. So I don't understand this
at all. What's going on?
I don't know.
Let's talk football then. And few encounters stir the passions as much as Arsenal versus Manchester United. Arsene Wenger versus Fergie, that's what it is. It's the quarterfinals of the Carling Cup this time, and of course, their last encounter ended in a food fight. Very much handbags it was, but more importantly, it went United's way. Arsenal have never really played the same since. Their confidence was certainly jolted. Joining me is Kenny Sansom, who used to play for Arsenal and a few other clubs, including England. Hello, Kenny, how are you?
Good morning.
Where have Arsenal been the last few weeks? They haven't quite been on that
it's
top form.
It's amazing. I mean, I obviously speak to quite a lot of Arsenal fans, and they're not playing. I think there's certain individuals not performing the way they did last year. And, you know, the unbeaten run against Manchester United, I think it did take a lot out of the team. And I think, as I say, people like Pires, Patrick Vieira, I thought last season was magnificent. They're not playing as well as they can. And,
but, I mean, it does
I think
happen,
that affects the team.
It?
Of course it does. You go for, you know, they're still in second spot in the league. That's not too bad, I don't think.
How important is the Carling Cup match tonight?
Well, I think the teams will say, oh, really, the big teams now, they don't really put their best 11 out. I'm saying there'll be a lot of youngsters, people like Van Persie and Flamini must be playing for Arsenal tonight. So it's more about possibly the more talk is about the managers.
Yeah.
You know, I think both of them will want to win, but they will not risk their big boys.
Fergie, I'm not allowed to call him that. Sir Alex Ferguson.
Sir Alex, yes.
He said the other day that Chelsea are the ones to keep an eye on them.
I think Chelsea have been fantastic. I think you get all the plaudits. I think Manchester United in the 90s were magnificent and everyone was praising them. I think Arsenal last season were outstanding, so they're praising them. And I think you've got to give a lot of credit to Chelsea and Mourinho and his team. They're playing very, very well, and at this moment in time, they're the best team in the country.
I think they're 5 points clear just at the moment. They played last night in the Carling Cup quarter-final against
Crosley, so he's a bit fortunate.
And Vicarage Road, bit of a classic night, actually.
Well, I think it's great. They beat Southampton, they've beaten Portsmouth, and they're the two sides from the south. And, you know, really, for Watford, it means so much, not only for the glory for the players and the fans, but I think financially, for Watford Football Club, it's very, very important.
Coca-Cola Championship there is actually more interest in the Premiership for some people.
Yeah,
you know, it's more like the old-fashioned leagues, isn't it?
It really is very, very tight. And I think if you look at the bottom and the top, it's very, very close.
Spurs-Liverpool, who wins tonight very briefly, Kenny?
Liverpool.
Yeah.
I might say that.
Yeah, they played well against Arsenal the weekend.
Yeah, they did.
Good talking to you, Kenny.
Thank you very much.
Penny.
Time is 12 minutes past six. You're watching the News Hour on GMTV. This morning's headlines. Letters published in the Daily Mail are threatening to embroil Home Secretary David Blunkett in greater controversy. They appear to show that a visa application for his lover's nanny was fast-tracked in just 19 days. Police are hunting two youths in connection with the murder of London banker John Monckton. He and his wife were stabbed at their home during an apparent attempted burglary. And MPs are planning the biggest crackdown on animal cruelty for almost a century. New legislation will require pet owners to give their animals the best possible care or face prosecution. Now, how would you react if this was your daughter? This is a home video showing teenager Jodie Duffin in hospital after she was knocked down as she tried to cross a road. The motorist involved in the accident fled the scene, and it was later revealed that he didn't have insurance. Well, this week he appeared in court, and as punishment he'll have to do 100 hours community service, undergo a rehabilitation programme and pay £70 court costs. But he won't go to jail, which is something that Jodie's parents say sends out the wrong message. Well, Amanda and Bob Duffin join me now, along with Jodie, who's thankfully better, and we have lawyer Paul Gilbert here as well. Good morning to you all. Jodie, how are you?
I'm all right.
You're all right. Is she all right? Because I know you always say you're all right and then you're not really.
Yeah, she is all right. I mean, she still can't do the physical side of things that she really, really wants to do.
Such as?
So it's holding about football, trampolining, gymnastics.
Right.
You know, the sort of what makes up Jodie's personality, really.
Right. But that's going to take time. You are going to be able to do those again.
Yes.
Hopefully.
It's just a matter of time. How much do you actually remember of this accident, Jodie?
Nothing.
Nothing at all. Right. How have you coped through all this? Because it's been a while, hasn't it?
We haven't coped very well at all, really. It's, well, just pulled us apart, really, you know, really mentally, physically, you know, really haven't coped very well at all.
Made it very difficult. Now, the driver, Ian Beasley, was given a maximum community service order for failing to stop and for driving without insurance. Now, as I understand it, he wasn't sentenced for careless or dangerous driving because the accident wasn't his fault and his insurance had run out only a day before the accident. You still aren't happy with the sentence there?
No,
it's just you're saying he got the maximum, but the maximum that's not good enough, is it? I mean, it should be stronger.
The law needs to be changed.
For drink, you know, any sort of driving offence, there's just no deterrent at all. I mean, you get young kids with cars, I mean, their insurance is higher than what
any fine
costs more than what the car would be. So they think, oh, well, it's going to cost me £1,000 to insure it. I won't bother getting insurance because if I get a fine, it's only going to be £100. So they drive away without insurance.
It is difficult, isn't it, Paul? Because, as you say, the problem is the average fine for driving without insurance is £150. We've got two quotes to insure a Ford Focus as a comparison. Now, for an 18-year-old student living in Norwich with no crashes, who has no points on his licence, the cheapest, 2000 £500. The most expensive was just over £3,500. And then we also got a quote for a 31-year-old office worker living in London. 3 years no claims bonus, the cheapest quote, £455. And the most expensive, more than £800. So when fines are so low and the cost of insurance so high, it's very easy to see why some people might think it's not worth the bother.
Oh, look, there's absolutely no doubt that what's not happening is that the right message is getting out in relation to driving without insurance. You are driving a car which is a potentially lethal weapon, and I think the images of Jodie demonstrate that very, very well. And really, the message that should be out there is you don't drive without insurance. It's a bit like the same decision about drinking and driving. Now, we're about to go into the Christmas drink drive campaign. There should be another campaign for driving without insurance. That man should not be been on the road on that day. That's the reality.
Although, as we were saying, it was only the day before, and I have to confess that I actually drove around without knowing that I had no insurance for 6 months because my insurance broker didn't actually tell me that my insurance had
been sacked from the firm. The car he was driving was the firm's car, and he'd been sacked, so he shouldn't have been driving it. He didn't have permission.
I mean, Penny, I hate to say it, and I would hate to criticise you for something that clearly you wouldn't know aware of. But you know, driving a car without insurance, I mean, the damage that it can do, the lives that it can ruin, you should have insurance.
Yeah. You know, well, I'd sue my insurance broker. I tell you, if something had happened. Well, we do have a statement on his behalf, actually. He appreciates, this is Ian Beasley's solicitor, he appreciates that there is nothing that he can say to make up for the distress suffered by Jodie and her family, but would like to take the opportunity to apologise for his actions. The magistrate's sentence should be seen in context of what Mr Beasley was actually being sentenced for. He was not, for example, sentenced for the accident or any injuries to Jodie Duffin, as he was not held culpable for the accident. There was an extensive police investigation into the incident, including an expert report and statements from 13 eyewitnesses, which exonerated Mr Beasley from blame. Now, I know that you started road safety campaigns in your area, haven't you?
That's right, yeah. The schools of Merton Council have actually started something in the schools called Curb Skills, where as volunteers, like parents, mums, just an hour a week, you go in and you would take two children out in a group, you know, with other parents and you know, under a proper controlled situation, and teach children the basics of crossing the road at a young age. So that's good. And the road where Jodie was knocked down, we're actually trying to reduce that to a 20-mile-an-hour road, and that seems to be sort of going through. So, you know, good things are coming out of this, but I just feel, you know, for what we suffered, you know, that 5 weeks in hospital, we lived at the hospital without our other children, this has to be taken into account, and it's happening time and time again where people are driving all the time with no insurance. They're killing. We're lucky we've got Jodie, you know, we are so lucky. There's so many people out there who haven't got their children or loved ones. And
absolutely,
it's happening time and time again with people who have got previous and they're still on the roads.
Well, Amanda and Bob Duffin and Jodie, thank you very much for coming in, and also Paul, thank you too.
Thank you.
Coming up to 20 past six this morning. Good morning to you. Here's a statistic, I'm afraid, that will horrify you. There's a burglary in Britain every 37 seconds, and the front page is today, and some of them dominated by the murder of John Monckton, who was stabbed to death when burglars broke into his home in London on Monday. His wife was seriously injured. Also this week, a 71-year-old priest was stabbed repeatedly at his house in Halifax after disturbing burglars. So is the law on burglary tough enough? Is this the right area to concentrate on? In a moment, we'll be talking to the former Chief Constable of West Yorkshire, that's Keith Helliwell. First, to Halifax and to Rachel Harrison. Are any of us safe in our own homes? Rachel.
Well, good morning. Well, Father Mike Ingwall certainly thought he was. He's lived and worked in this community for more than 12 years and was committed to it. Just a few months ago, he said that he intended to continue working despite the fact that he's 71 and that he had no intention of retiring. That said, the father was a realist. He'd lived here and had been burgled twice, which is why he went to every precaution he could and fitted a burglar alarm to the outside of his building. And in fact, it was that alarm that alerted him to the fact that there may have been an intruder in his house. It was late at night. He got out of bed, he went down, and that's when he was repeatedly stabbed in the head and in the body. Now, this morning, he's in a stable condition in hospital. He has two punctured lungs and is said to be in shock at what's happened. Now, this is all too common a problem, unfortunately. As we've heard, John Monckton, the city banker, was attacked on the same night. A burglary, it appears, is on the increase, as my colleague Matt Arnold's been finding out.
There are parts of this city where if you don't lock up,
you're likely to get some unwanted visitors. Do you hear of burglaries going on in the area?
You do, and you also hear the tales of people actually going down the streets and trying the door handles to see if the doors have actually been locked, and that's quite concerning.
With 7,213 burglaries last year alone, Leeds has got the worst figures in England and Wales. And where I'm standing now, Chestnut Avenue in the Hyde Park area, is apparently Britain's most burgled street.
One night a few years ago, all the houses in the street were burgled in one evening.
Like a lot of residents in Hyde Park, these girls are students. But one man who didn't want to be identified blames the appalling statistics on the lack of community.
Crime is really rife in the area. I myself, my car was broken into. Somebody actually tried setting my car on fire. But you get teenagers hanging around the area looking for opportunities, and the opportunities are there because there's no sense of community.
Does it worry you living here?
It does. I do often joke to people about living in the Bronx in Leeds.
Nationally, rates are falling, but with 1,600 break-ins here in a month recently, there's a long way to go.
Matt Arnold and Rachel Harrison with reports there. Former Chief Constable of West Yorkshire Police, Keith Helliwell, joining me now. Good morning to you, Keith. Home Office says burglary in Britain every 37 seconds. It's not surprising that people are scared now.
No, it isn't, and I mean, it's a tragic figure. If you can't be safe and feel safe in your own home, then where can you feel safe?
No, that's exactly right. I mean, the neighbours of the Monktons, this family that have suffered so much just two nights ago in this very nice part of London, it has to be said, the neighbours were saying that they were scanning the street before going into their door. They had CCTV put up there. I mean, they had the means to do that. They even employed a private patrol. I mean, what can protect us, Keith?
Well, I think we've got to come down to the root causes of burglary, why people are committing burglary. One of the reasons is they don't care anymore. Firstly, because the likelihood of them being caught is reducing month by month. And secondly, if they are caught, they may well not receive any sentence that is meaningful at all. So we need to put that certainty back into our criminal justice system.
Now, this concept of reasonable force and about what you're able to do in the case of a burglary or any crime taking place, or any threat, in fact, taking place in your home. Now, what are people supposed to do, and what constitutes reasonable force, Keith?
Well, I think the first thing is we need to make it clear to burglars as a society that we won't tolerate it. Over the last 20 or 30 years, we've almost had a health and safety promotion for burglars. We can't protect our houses physically. The people used to put glass on the top of their walls, which was no longer allowed. Others would have dogs in the yard, no longer allowed because it may hurt the burglar. And then people who have defended themselves have actually been found themselves before court and sentenced for an offence. So a burglar says, well, the likelihood of my being caught is very limited, and even if I am caught and I'm hurt, then I can sue the person who's hurt me. This is absolutely ridiculous. Yeah. As far as reasonable force is concerned, then it is a very, very grey area. You are supposed to match the force that is against you. You're supposed to retreat as much as you can before you act. But this is not reality. If a woman wakes up or a man wakes up in bed and there's somebody in the bedroom armed with whatever it might be, or even if they're not armed, the threat of that is so frightening that people react. And if they react in a reasonable way, as far as I'm concerned, they should not be prosecuted, but the burglar certainly should.
You'll certainly have a lot of support for that around the country, Keith. Thank you very much for joining us this morning.
24 minutes past six after the break, we're live down under for an exclusive interview with Paul Burrell's family.
And can the former Royal Butler serve up the goods in the fight to be crowned King of the Jungle? We'll see.
Seven celebrities still eking out an existence in the Australian rainforest, but funny man Vic Reeves is off for an early bath after last night's vote. Jenny Falconer is our jungle correspondent. Jenny, what's been going on overnight?
Okay, well, while you're sleeping, Huggy's actually done something.
He has, in fact, done a bush tucker trial. It's about time he did something, because I think he was going to get the axe tonight if he didn't. And the rest of the guys have voted for him to do the bush tucker trial, so you never know. Maybe this will save him, and he'll stay in tonight. You never know. And also, while you've been asleep, Joe and Paul have gone off to do a celebrity chess. You know, they're quite a funny double act, so they've gone off to do that. And Paul's been expressing how he fancies a job in television. So, watch out, Andrew. You might have some competition there.
Yeah, please. He can have it. He can have it. It's fine.
And talking of Paul Burrell, you have some guests there with you who are very close to him.
I do indeed. I have Maria, Paul's wife, and Nick and Alex's sons. Now, I've got to say, you wrote a letter to Paul. Right. It was on the show last night, and you said you're very proud of him. Uh-huh. What are you most proud of?
I think we're most proud just being how he's just himself, and the dad that we love. He's just everything that he's done from day one, jumping out of a plane. I mean, that talk about throwing the deep end. So just everything he's done has just made us so proud, especially for me and Nick. We just love him so much, and he's been absolutely amazing. So
because a lot of people, when they come out, the first thing they say is, "Oh, I wasn't edited fairly." A lot of people are saying that Sophie wasn't edited fairly because we didn't know she was quite so moody or whatever. Do you think Paul's been edited fairly? Is that what he's like?
Yeah, I think so. The only thing is the singing. We told him, "Don't you dare sing," and he's gone and sung.
That's just himself, isn't he? He does that all the time.
He's always singing.
Oh, no, well, he is doing really well in there. I mean, he's conquering some of his fears. Well, maybe he's tackling some of his fears. What was he scared of in the first place?
He doesn't like snakes.
And right. Water. He
doesn't like deep water.
No.
And he obviously doesn't like jumping out of planes either, because we saw that. But the thing is, though, the fact is that he announced that he was a secret chef, okay?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Is this true, or is it all just made up?
He went to catering college. Yeah, he is. He's a trained chef.
Oh, really? So therefore, the jungle viper is being a little bit cruel, isn't she? What do you make of that relationship, Janet?
Well, at first, I thought she was, not being very nice, but I think they're just playing off against each other. I think people are like to see it as well, because they need something to entertain them, and they're sitting around, or when they've done their jobs, they've got to have something. So Paul and Janet, I think it's not like
an aggressive argument. It's really funny. I think they really do like each other, but it's just, it's a little bit of a
love-hate relationship.
I'll tell you what, let's have a look and see if the viewers can judge for themselves.
Get out of my food chest!
I didn't want to see what we're going to have to eat.
Enough information. Do you want to do a handwritten menu for the drawing room?
No, thank you.
Paul.
Like we did when we were kids.
I told you off about a chicken stew, and you're on your second formal warning now.
Oh.
And you know what a third warning is? A send-off.
Oh.
He really is getting tougher, and he's also getting thinner.
Yeah.
Is this a good move?
It is a real good thing. Yeah. I mean, he's been hammering the gym before he went in, so he's lost a lot of weight from recent months and stuff. But recently, obviously being in the jungle, he's lost so much weight, and he's even getting a little six-pack.
Okay. Yeah, and he's lost his tummy.
Yeah, he's really gone thin.
Okay, well, Luke, thank you very much. Back to you in the studio.
Jenny Falconer, our jungle correspondent, without, it appears to me, ever having been into the jungle. Marina today, hotel yesterday.
Boating correspondent,
exactly.
Right.
Yeah. Now, don't forget you can catch up on all the jungle gossip during the day by going to the website gm.tv.
OK, coming up in the next half an hour, we've got Gail Port here, Claire Sweeney as well, and we'll be meeting an incredibly brave boy in half an hour's time as well. Before all that,
the weather with Claire.
GMTV weather, sponsored by Topps Tiles. Brightening homes, whatever the weather.
Hello, good morning. I'm at Valley International Park, Crosford, South Lanarkshire, southwest Scotland. It's feeling really Christmassy here this morning. It's the 1st of December, and behind me is the largest Christmas tree, or the tallest Christmas tree, not only in Britain, but also in Europe. In fact, at the moment, they're bidding for the title of tallest Christmas tree actually in the whole world, so they could get into the Guinness Book of Records. And as you can see there, that amazing little star, well, little from this angle, but actually it's very big, a star on the top of the Christmas tree. I don't know, actually put that up there, but they must be very brave indeed. 41 metres, 134 feet. Now this morning the clouds has cleared from South Lanarkshire. It was very drizzly earlier, and in fact I think we could see some fog patches before the end of the night. In fact, fog patches are a problem this morning across Northern Ireland, as well as central, western and northern areas of Scotland. Scotland, and down towards the southeast of England, eastern and central areas of England. They will only slowly clear through the morning. They could linger in one or two spots. Also a problem with frost this morning. Temperatures sub-zero where the cloud has cleared. Now in the middle, that's where we're seeing a lot of cloud this morning, anywhere from southeast Scotland down towards northern England, Wales, the West Country and eastern areas of Ireland. And here we're seeing bits and pieces of drizzle and also a little bit of rain across Cumbria as well as Solway. Through the day, that will tend to peter out, but it will remain cloudy here. In fact, the cloud continuing across Humberside as well as Midlands down towards Wales. But to the southeast of that, that's where you'll see some brighter spells during the day, despite the fact the fog could linger for a time. And also the best and the sunniest weather will be across eastern and western areas of Ireland, as well as central, western and northern areas of Scotland. And temperatures today, well, 6 in the north, 10 in the south, 4 to 5 where that fog lingers, better if you are along the coast. And tonight, the lowest temperatures will be across Scotland and Northern Ireland, down to minus 2. Patchy fog and frost further south, but there will be more cloud here. And then tomorrow, a better day all round, most of seeing a little bit of sunshine. Here's your summary. Find out what our weather's up to for the next 5 days on our website, gm.tv.
Good morning, it's 6:32. It's Wednesday, it's the 1st of December, just 24 more days to go.
Panic. You're watching the news air here on GMTV. In the next half an hour, actress and singer Claire Sweeney joins us to tell us how she experienced firsthand the suffering of children in Africa caused by HIV/AIDS.
And television presenter Gail Porter will be here to tell us why she's joined a whole host of celebrities campaigning to help protect animals from cruelty.
First this morning, letters published in the Daily Mail are threatening to embroil Home Secretary David Blunkett in greater controversy. They appear to show that a visa application for his lover's nanny was fast-tracked in just 19 days. Sue Jameson is at Westminster for us this morning. And this route just, well, it has a long way to go, Sue, doesn't it?
It does. I mean, this looks like another extremely large political log chucked on the fire, because these are pretty clearly dated letters that are in the Daily Mail that appear to show a remarkable turnaround in the backlog of visa applications, because on the 23rd of April 2003, the letter to Luce Kasami, the nanny, says that there is a backlog, she could wait a year, and then on the 12th of May, just 19 days later, she's told that her visa application has been approved. Now, it must be said that these do not implicate Mr. Blunkett in themselves, that they're part of the circumstantial detail, I suppose, that's going to be followed up by Sir Alan Budd. He's the man who very swiftly has to follow this paper trail. He must be doing it at a bit of a run at the moment, because the most important thing is to find out what actually happened to the nanny's application form. Who touched it? Where did it go to? Were there any special instructions? Now, Mr. Blunkett, to have a resigning matter, for example, must be proven to have done something wrong. At the moment, he says he hasn't, the Home Office says he hasn't, and of course, he has the full backing of the Prime Minister. There are some other allegations, too, to do with privileges, for example, like police protection, travel that Mr. Blunkett said to have given to Mrs. Quinn. He's already owned up to one of them, rail tickets, but the Tories say they want more investigation on those two, although they're less serious allegations.
OK, Sue, thank you very much indeed.
26 minutes to seven. Let's cross to Jackie now at the news desk.
Thank you, Penny. Good morning. Police are hunting two youths after a London banker was stabbed to death in his home. John Monckton and his wife were attacked during what appears to have been an attempted robbery on their house in the Chelsea district. Jonathan Swain is there. Good morning, Jonathan. Now, will Mrs. Monckton be able to help the police?
Well, Hamira Monckton would have seen everything that happened in the house behind me. That door is where the attackers pushed their way in before launching a vicious attack which killed John Monckton as he was trying to defend his home. His wife was also stabbed, and we understand that this morning she's still in an unconscious condition in a London hospital, so it'll be some time yet before the police manage to speak to her. Well, all of this was witnessed by their 9-year-old daughter, who thankfully made the emergency 999 call, which in the end probably helped to save her mum's life. Well, this area, as you can see, is lived in by the well-heeled and the extremely well-off. And yesterday, when I spent some time here, people here weren't surprised by the break-in, but of course they were shocked by the murder, and police are appealing for witnesses to come forward.
Jonathan, thank you. Detectives in Scotland believe a bank manager shot dead at his home in Nairn at the weekend may have been the victim of a grudge. Police are searching for an envelope given to 30-year-old Alistair Wilson by his killer moments before he was shot 3 times. The attacker fled with the envelope. Mr. Wilson's widow, Veronica, is to make an appeal for information later this morning. Police are investigating claims that a 15-year-old boy who died after a fight at school was the victim of bullying.
Two 14-year-old boys are being questioned in connection with the incident at Broadoak High School in Greater Manchester. David Thomas Sandham died in hospital yesterday following the altercation. Police in Manchester swooped on a number of properties in a series of anti-terror raids last night. The raids on two properties in the suburb of Rusholme and a third property nearby followed the arrest of a man in Manchester. There were reports of scuffles between police and residents after news emerged of the raids. Finally, the festive season got underway in America last night with the traditional lighting of the Christmas tree at the Rockefeller Center in New York. This year's tree is the biggest and brightest in its 70-year history, 71 feet high and studded with 30,000 lights. Cordelia Kretschmar was there for the big moment.
And hello, everyone, and welcome to Christmas in Rockefeller Center, one of New York's greatest holiday traditions.
Underneath the Christmas tree last night, crowds of more than 100,000.
This is the most beautiful place in the world tonight. Just look at the tree, it's gorgeous.
Olympic gold medalists, American Idol stars, and Jessica Simpson, the golden girl of American entertainment. All gathered for this moment.
It began life as one family's little Christmas tree back in the 1950s. Today, it's 10 stories high and the most famous tree in the world.
Cordelia Kretschmar, GMTV News in New York.
Very Christmassy. 6:37, back now to Penny.
Thanks very much, Anne. We can return now to our top story now and those latest reports claiming that the Home Secretary David Blunkett's former lover's nanny got her visa in 19 days after having been told it could take up to a year. That's the front page of the Daily Mail. Revealed nanny got her visa in 19 days. Well, joining me on the line now is Clive Betts, Labour MP for Sheffield Attercliffe and a friend of David Blunkett of the Home Secretary. Good morning to you.
Good morning.
It doesn't look good for Mr Blunkett, does it?
Well, I'm sorry. I think what the Mail has got is a number of allegations, a bit of information, and what they're trying to do now is to drip feed this out day by day and try and create the impression for people that there's a lot of smoke around and therefore there must be a fire somewhere. You know, if the Mail's got the information, hard information, it should pass it on to the inquiry which Sir Alan Budd is undertaking and let him investigate it and look at these matters.
Yes, I mean, you're a friend of Mr Blunkett, as I said.
Yeah.
Do you think he's done anything improper, possibly because he just wanted to help a friend in need?
No, I'm quite certain. Well, David Blunkett has said to me, and he said publicly, that in his position as Home Secretary, he did not misuse that position to gain favour or advantage in a private matter. I believe him in this, and what we have here are two letters from the immigration people, but absolutely no evidence that David Blunkett was implicated in this in any way. What the Mail is trying to do is to put the two letters down and say, well, he must have been involved, mustn't he? The inquiry's been set up to investigate what David Blunkett did or didn't do. I believe David Blunkett's very clear assertion that he didn't use his influence as Home Secretary to gain any proper advantage in this case.
Well, actually, I mean, you're accusing the Daily Mail, but in fact, it appears to me that a lot of this is coming from his ex-lover. I mean, how do you feel about this whole situation?
Well, I mean, it's a very tragic situation where two people clearly had a very close relationship. It breaks down, there's acrimony around, and then, you know, allegations start to fly, and then the papers pick them up, and then the Mail is clearly trying to use this for political advantage. You know, the Mail must have known this some days ago. It should have said at the time, this is the information we have. We're going to pass it all over to the inquiry. The inquiry now under Sir Alan Budd will investigate everything to do with the allegations about the visa. He will conduct it independently, without favour, and he will produce a report then which the public will see, and I'm sure it will exonerate David Blunkett when it's produced.
Clive Betts, thank you very much.
It's the 1st of December, World AIDS Day. We'll be talking about that with Claire Sweeney. She had a trip down to South Africa after we find out what's happening where you are.
Hello there, a very good morning to you. Searches are set to resume on three properties in Manchester raided last night under the Terrorism Act. Greater Manchester Police say the raids followed information received when a man was arrested. Tim Scott reports.
Police raided three properties, two on Great Western Street in Rusholme and one on Heald Place. There were angry scenes outside the house on Heald Place where an elderly disabled woman was taken away from her home so forensic officers could enter the premises. Officers say the raids came as a result of information received following the arrest of a man on Monday. Local residents are accusing the police of heavy-handed tactics.
I've known all my life. I am sure that officers say I've got no evidence at all that this lady has committed any terrorism.
We see no point in our elders, our disabled people, being arrested and treated in this manner. It's absolutely absurd.
Greater Manchester Police are expected to release further information about the operation later this morning.
Police in Greater Manchester will continue to question two 14-year-old boys this morning following the death of another schoolboy. 15-year-old David Sandham, who attended Broadoak High School in Partington, died yesterday afternoon, as Robbie Skotsky reports.
Mums comforting their children at the school gates. Some youngsters reduced to tears at the news of the tragedy as pupils were sent home last night. Youngsters were told about David Sandham's death during a specially arranged assembly. More details are expected to emerge during the course of today, but it's believed an argument broke out in an annex building at the back of the school, which is on Warburton Lane. Staff battled to revive David, who has one sister and four brothers, but later in hospital he was pronounced dead. It's understood no weapon was involved and a post-mortem examination is taking place to establish the cause of death. Local councillors say everyone's devastated by David's death, a sentiment likely to be echoed by many of the 420 pupils at the school.
Liverpool and Everton are due to meet Sports Minister Richard Caborn today to discuss suggestions the two football clubs should share the same stadium. Both clubs are looking to move from their current homes to accommodate larger crowds and better facilities. The Reds already have plans to leave Anfield for a new ground at Stanley Park. However, Everton's plans to build a new stadium at King's Dock fell through. That's it for now. Back at 7:05. Next, the weather.
Brighten up your winter with the fresh smell of summer.
Fog lingering in parts this morning and there'll be spots of rain in the north. Hazy sunshine this afternoon, but some of that fog will persist. Temperature today, just 5 Celsius, 41 degrees Fahrenheit.
Seven this morning. Now, as World AIDS Day gets underway this morning, it's estimated over 50,000 people in Britain are living with the disease, whilst nearly 1 million children in Africa faced life as AIDS orphans in 2005. Well, Claire Sweeney has just come back from the St Nicholas Children's Hospice in Africa on behalf of Save the Children. We'll be speaking to Claire in just a moment. First, a look at what she experienced there.
This is St Nicholas Hospice. It's supported by Save the Children. And each of the flowers on this wall is in memory of a child who's died here from AIDS. And it really brings death and life. The work here is about making the children's lives as happy as possible. And it may be hard to believe, but this is actually an incredibly positive place. Some of the children here are very sick, but they can still get a lot of comfort just by being with other children and playing together.
This little girl came to us about 2 weeks ago. She's an orphan and she's looked after by her granny. But she was really very sick and very confused with her illness as well.
I'm not sure how old this little one is. Look. He's got AIDS as well. It's just heartbreaking.
There's an intimacy here that's almost like being part of a family. And meeting these children and Save the Children workers is an experience I will never forget.
There you go.
Claire, thanks for coming in and thanks for going over there as well. Did you find it in any way an uplifting experience? I always find going into a hospice, children's one particularly, that the spirits can be raised in an odd way.
Bizarrely, yeah. I was kind of dreading it because that was the last day of the trip going into the kids' hospice. And I was quite nervous about it, and surprisingly I walked into the garden and I saw all the kids playing. There was all toys and everything in the garden, and I looked at this gorgeous wall filled with sunflowers, and when I looked at it closely there was a name in each little sunflower, and it's for each child that had died there. And I got attached to the little boy at the end who waved at the camera.
Was that Godfrey?
That was Godfrey. Oh, he was gorgeous.
Like?
9 years of age, absolutely lovely. And I really bonded with this kid. And we were sat, we were playing on a swing together. There he is. And he was playing with my mobile phone. I don't think he'd ever seen a mobile, but he soon worked out how to play all the games. So he's playing with the games, and we were sat hugging each other playing, then suddenly he says, oh, I've got to go and get my medication. And it suddenly hit me then, I thought, this kid's gorgeous, but I don't know what the future holds for this kid.
Everything's normal, but it isn't.
It isn't. But the place is really positive, and their aim, they're funded by Save the Children, and their aim is to make the last few months or the last few years of the kids' lives as happy as possible.
Mm. See, it's at a time when South Africa is, well, it's gone past the crossroads. Things have been looking really rather good for South Africa in so many different ways, and, you know, transition to a democratic government and all the rest of it. But, you know, so many workers, carers, entire families wiped out. I mean, the whole system is just under an enormous strain now. The numbers, you can't really get your head around them.
It's, you know, in England, see, my best friend died of AIDS and in the 90s, and it was kind of perceived as predominantly a gay disease and, and an adult disease. And it wasn't until I went to South Africa and I had that baby I held in my arms had AIDS. I was meeting orphans whose parents had died of AIDS, mothers who had AIDS, and it was suddenly, gosh, this is really extreme, and it was completely different to, you know, how it was perceived over here or in the States or whatever.
Because the misconception sort of comes when you're dealing with sort of adult male human beings in, in this country, people think, well, they made their own choices. That was the judgment they made when AIDS came out, HIV came out first, wasn't it? And it was wrong. And it almost takes the suffering of children for us all to open our eyes, doesn't it?
Yeah, or for me as a woman to meet, I mean, I'm involved with a charity called Sahir House, which is an AIDS charity in Liverpool, and I went there and I met a woman who had AIDS and I met her son, and I suddenly thought, God, this is different, you know, and what is great now, I think there's going to be a new big campaign to raise, you know, in the 80s we were all quite aware of it, early 90s, and now the next generation are going to be educated about it.
Yeah, good things. Claire? A very good trip. Thanks for telling us about it.
And
you can find out more about Save the Children World AIDS Day on our website, gm.tv.
Time is 12 minutes to 7. You're watching the News Hour on GMTV. One story dominating the headlines today, letters published in the Daily Mail threatening to embroil Home Secretary David Blunkett in more controversy. They appear to show that a visa application for his lover's nanny was fast-tracked in just 19 days. Now, thousands of animals suffer terrible abuse at the hands of their owners every year, and today the RSPCA is launching a campaign to encourage us to back a new bill to stop that cruelty. Amongst the charity's celebrity supporters, TV presenter Gail Porton, she's joined us this morning with Missy.
Yes.
The lovely dog, being very well behaved, isn't
she? She's been very good, as you see.
She was being very good.
Missy,
as quiet as anything.
Missy,
well, while we get Missy back on the chair, you actually went out with an RSPCA officer.
Yes, I did, Mike.
To actually go and see the squalid conditions some animals live in. Yeah. And before we chat, we're going to look at some of the suffering that you witnessed.
Once they get out, what they do is they're not scared of people. They don't just hide. It's because they never have the boxes.
They're like sitting in this all week.
I know.
We're never going. She's decided she wants to be busy.
Never work with children or animals.
Exactly. Missy, sit.
There we go.
You see, look how well-behaved she is when I say it in a firm and commanding voice. Now, that, and she did.
I know. She doesn't do that for me.
Yes, but those conditions that you witnessed, they were horrible, weren't they?
Yeah, it was just a bizarre day. You know, I went out with Mike, the guy that you saw there, and basically we went to a couple of different homes and saw just different conditions that animals are kept in. And because the animal legislation, it dates back to 1911, it hasn't been changed since 1911, that, you know, as you see there, the woman with this cat, she has 7 cats, and they were sitting in their own mess. They never get let out of those cages. I put my hand in to touch one of them and it was so terrified. But because if a vet goes in there and it can't say, yes, this is clinically suffering, she can keep those cats. She also had 23 rabbits out the back in cages that you wouldn't keep. It was just awful. It was so upsetting.
Did you speak to the woman?
She just was not interested because, as far as she was concerned, it was her right to have her cats and she could do what she liked with them. And so basically, what we're trying to do with this film, and there's quite a few people involved in it, Miranda Richardson, and we've all been out and seen it for ourselves. And this little film will come out for the RSPCA today. There's a press launch today, and then it will be in the Daily Mail, a DVD that you can get on Saturday. And basically, we're hoping that people will phone up their MPs and say, look, we need this legislation changed. So that,
this campaign is called 25 Reasons for a New Animal Welfare Bill, isn't it? And the 25 reasons, just, well, I mean, you see rather a lot of reasons just there.
There's so many different reasons, like that, you know, the woman with the cat, basically, because there's no, you know, no one can say, well, actually, she's not fit to have the cats, she can have the cats. And it just, you know...
Even though they're sitting in their own mess and all the rest of it.
And even just giving guidelines to people that got pets. Like Missy here is a Sharpie, and when we got Missy, you know, we went straight to the vet, because she's not the same as normal dogs, and she's got little small ears, and she's got all the wrinkles, and she needs special care, she needs to eat specific things. And, you know, if people get these guidelines, then animals are going to get looked after much more, you know.
Well, because the main change in the law, as I understand it, is that the owners have a duty of care.
Yes, absolutely.
They actually have to care for their owners rather than actually be proved to be
causing
them
distress.
And I can't see,
you know, people have got all sorts of crazy excuses saying, well, it's my animal, I don't need to have any duty of anything. But you wouldn't treat a child like that, so why treat an animal like that? They've got as much right to be here as we have. So if you're going to look after an animal, then you have to give it the proper care and respect and look after it and take it for walks and don't let it sit in its own mess. And it was horrible. I saw some dogs chained up that never got, you know, they weren't ever undercover. And it was, and these poor guys like Mike, who goes out, and he actually can't do anything because of the legislation. So, you know, you can see from the conditions there, things like that have to change. You can't keep animals like that.
Right. So the way that viewers can get involved is through the Daily Mail, is it?
Daily Mail, they can get a DVD, and I'm sure if you contact the RSPCA, they'll give you a number to call. I know there's text numbers. You can text into your local MP and try and get this bill changed.
OK. Gail, thank you very much.
Thank you for having us.
And more on the RSPCA campaign also on the website, gm.tv. Thanks, Gail.
Thank you. Now she's chilled out.
Just gone 10 to 7 this morning. Now, for the story of an incredibly brave little boy. Charlie Stevens here is just 5 years of age, and he's been battling a brain tumour since the age of 2, and he's going to beat it. Things are now looking up for him, and yesterday they were made just a little bit easier. Charlie's mum is here, Julia, sister Ella, and dad John as well. Welcome to One and All. Charlie, everything OK? You all right?
Yep.
What happened yesterday?
Who did we go and see?
Brian McFadden.
Brian McFadden, what did he say to you? Do you remember what he said to you?
He said you were very brave, didn't he?
I was very brave.
You were very brave. Yeah, I know you're very brave. You've got an amazing story. What exactly has happened so far in Charlie's life?
Well, he was diagnosed with a tumour when he was 2.5. Yeah. And
I've had the treatment.
You've had lots of treatment. He's had 3 major brain operations, radiotherapy, a 6-week course, chemotherapy into his cyst, over 60 anaesthetics within 2 years. So it's been really hard on him.
And yesterday he was awarded a star, wasn't he, by Cancer Research UK.
This
was the Little Star campaign, part of these fundraising campaign
that's
leading
right.
up to Christmas to sort of raise awareness of the bravery shown.
That's it, to recognise what they actually go through and the siblings as well.
And Ella got a similar certificate, didn't she, John?
Yeah, she did.
Was it nice meeting Brian? Is he a decent man? Is he like, no, is he a nice bloke?
Yeah.
He was lovely, wasn't he? Yeah.
And what's your brother been like? Has he been brave?
Yeah.
And does he like having you around when he's having his treatments and things like that? Do you love him? Do you love him so much that you can't even talk about him? You love him so much. I bet you do. Has she been good to you, Charlie?
Yeah,
she loves you, doesn't she? And she helps you out, doesn't she?
Yeah.
Because he's registered blind now as well.
Yeah.
The only treatment that I don't like when I wake up is, you know, sometimes when I have my scans, they put a camera in, and when I wake up, I get all grumpy and cross.
He gets a bit cross with all
and
the doctors.
He does that, and he doesn't have any of that.
Too. Yeah.
You are both little stars, and your parents are big stars as well. So
we got little stars for you both to wear.
All right.
For Cancer Research
That's
UK.
Great. That's for you, Penny. Thank you so much for coming in this morning. If you'd like to nominate a little star, part of Cancer Research UK's lead up to Christmas, go to the website for details, gm.tv.
And that's it from the news. Eamon and Fiona here next.
Joining them, Big Brother winner Nadia with her debut single, Steve Brookstein from X Factor as well. It's a showbiz fest.
Next, it's the weather with Claire.